Reparations, okay, let's do this.
It's time to acknowledge openly that much of Europe and the United States have been built from the vast wealth harvested from the sweat, tears, blood and horrors of the transatlantic slave trade and the centuries of colonial exploitation. Reparations must be paid.
That's Ghana's president on reparations, but what exactly are they?
That means, you know, reclaiming back what they have taken from us, our pride, our dignity.
It can't be repaid back. The years have been lost. Things have been damaged. The best they can do is encourage us and let us just work on our own.
Monetary reparation is just one aspect of it, but it should be more a moral aspect.
Reparation is compensation, breaking the chain of bondage, and also giving back.
Reparations are important. They mean different things to different people. So I've been thinking about these three questions. What are reparations? Why is it not just about getting money? And what could it look like for Africa? To get some answers, I've been speaking to human rights lawyer Andrew Songa. He's worked on reparation cases across Africa for over a decade.
I think money is the most tangible and familiar form of reparations within compensation, but it's not the only form of reparations that exists and it cannot be a holistic approach.
So if it's not just about the money, what are the other forms of reparations?
You have restitution being the first port of call, and restitution is about trying to put the person back into the position they were in before the harm they suffered. For example, if you lose your land, restitution can be giving you back that piece of land you lost. If you lost cultural artifacts, as a lot of African communities have done, restitution could be returning those artifacts back to the communities they belong to. And then you also have the aspect of satisfaction. And the most common features of satisfaction tend to be public acknowledgements or apologies that perhaps a government can make. You also have rehabilitation. So for example, you have people who are wrongly accused, detained and jailed, having their criminal records expunged so that they can be able to come back into society. You also have the very important aspect of the guarantees of non-recurrence. These are measures that governments or those in power take to ensure that whatever environment allowed for violations to take place, those environments are remedied. So it could be about policy and institutional reform to ensure that we don't create future victims.
When it comes to slavery or colonial rule, none of the reparation attempts so far have met all five forms. But there are historical examples of reparations in other contexts. Since World War II, Germany has paid over $90 billion to individual Holocaust survivors and their heirs. These payments continue today, with a further $1.4 billion pledged in 2023. The government also agreed to a one-off payment of $7 billion in today's money to Israel in 1952. So what about in Africa?
In Nairobi, capital of Kenya, Europeans and Africans still walk the streets in fear of the dreaded Mau Mau.
In 2013, the UK government agreed to pay nearly $30 million in an out-of-court settlement to Kenyans tortured by British colonial forces during the Mau Mau uprising in the 1950s. The UK government told us it had expressed regrets for the abuses committed, and that the most effective way to respond to past wrongs is by ensuring current and future generations learn lessons and work together to tackle today's challenges. In 2015, they also funded a monument commemorating the veterans. More recently, in 2021, Germany agreed to pay more than $1.3 billion after officially recognizing its colonial soldiers had committed genocide between 1904 and 1908 in Namibia. Rather than calling the payout reparations, it was called a grant instead. To understand the implications of this, I spoke to reparations activist Esther Kosei.
Germany, even though it has acknowledged the Over Herero and Nama genocide, is still trying to call the shots and absolve itself from as much responsibility as possible by referring to this as development aid. It is not in fulfillment or recognition of serious crimes that have been committed against a group such as the crimes of genocide. Aid is something that really is down to, oftentimes, the benevolence of particular governments. It is not an obligation under international law. It is still very much, dare I say, a form of charity.
The German government says the payout is neither aid or reparations. The funds can't be reparations as they were made out of a moral and historical obligation rather than a legal one. These payments are not linked to any other form of development aid. The money is meant to go directly to projects in the affected communities and region where they'll decide how it's spent. Those three examples cover a specific time, group of people, and location. So, what about slavery and colonial rule? Well, momentum seems to be picking up, with demands from former colonies getting louder. In November 2023, African and Caribbean delegates got together in Ghana, demanding formal apologies from European countries. They also set up a global reparations fund, but they didn't say how it would work. How do you even put a number on something like slavery? Well, I've looked into it and several groups have tried, and the figures have ranged from billions to trillions depending on how it's worked out. £20 million, or nearly $2.5 billion in today's money. That's how much slave owners were compensated by the British government when slavery ended. A debt the UK only finished paying off in 2015. Some former colonies have used the same measure to say that's how much they should be compensated. A report co-authored by top UN judge Patrick Robinson took a different approach. They calculated that over $107 trillion would need to be paid by 31 former slaveholding states. This includes Britain, the US, Spain, and France. The figures based on the five harms committed during slavery and slightly after. These are loss of liberty, loss of earning, personal injury, gender-based violence, and mental pain and anguish. But for Esther, there's a key missing piece.
The report is totally silent on what is owed to Africa. The report indicates that specific sums of money should go to countries in the diaspora, that is outside of Africa. It is very disproportionate because it implies and it reinforces a fiction that the harm was just done to those of us that were taken out of the continent. It doesn't recognize the harm that those who remained in Africa, what they suffered.
The question of who should pay has been divisive. Should it be nation states or individual organizations like churches and universities that have historical links? And who should receive the payments? For Esther, it's important that descendants like her on the continent and outside have a voice in reparation talks.
We have never been asked as to whether we consent to existing governments, whether in Africa or anywhere else, to actually negotiate finite sums of money on behalf of our foreparents.
Despite all the unresolved questions, for Esther and Andrew, collective reparations are worth pursuing.
I understand the hesitation sometimes that comes with thinking about the sheer scale. You can't truly ever quantify a lost life and fully atone for it. Or you can't contemplate fully what it means to destroy a culture or what it means to break apart a community. We can see that the debate of reparations is indeed picking up and that some of the global north countries are being responsive. It is important to consolidate these experiences and therefore say what you are beginning to acknowledge is actually depictive of the experience of the whole continent, and we can therefore move forward and discuss and make the claims for reparations as a continent towards some of the former colonial states.
Reparations are actually complex. They are not just a simple matter of paying back some money. We lost a lot more than money. The first thing that communities want is to be heard. to be listened to. Much of the ongoing crimes and violations of African people's rights on the continent of Africa, first of all, are not being recognised.
With increasing calls for reparations in Africa, some institutions like museums have started returning stolen artefacts. Recently, more European nations have started to recognise their role in the legacy of slavery and colonial era violence. But it remains to be seen whether there will be real political commitments to meaningful reparation talks.